Thank you. Eternis genis habitatio comparatur. Thank you. his jacket on and his tie. Matthew didn't, of course. So when we arrived at the reception, they assumed, of course, that it wasn't Matthew, the Grand Master, but our host. And he liked that too, because humility has to be genuine. And it has to be heartfelt and lived with a certain joy. And Matthew had it. I can't say, and he was certainly not said, that he always felt joyful in Rome for various reasons. Let's say Rome was a little too complicated for him. And so he would escape from time to time. His attempts to learn Italian weren't vastly successful either, but caused a certain amount of joy or merriment, at any rate, amongst the Italians, because unlike the French, we shouldn't say this, the Italians don't mind you making a hash of their language. But all the time, he did his best in circumstances and in a context in which he was never entirely at home. And we know where he was at home. He was at home in Northumberland, and he was also very much at home in Lourdes. He loved Our Lady, and there he could help the sick in a very practical way. As you know, he offloaded them at the station for many years, and he continued to do that when he was Grand Master. And again, the sick hadn't the slightest idea of who he was. And as he got weaker physically, he still insisted on going. And again, he overheard someone say, where they were from, oh, look at that poor old thing. Why don't they do something for him? Well, God did something for him. He gave him a great possibility to exercise patience and forbearance under extremely difficult circumstances. And he did it with obedience and with determination to try to do God's will. And that's all that any of us can ask for, to try to do God's will. And so, frankly, it is, we don't have to mourn. We mourn his physical presence, and there was a lot of it. We also mourn his capacity for affection. Like many Northerners, he didn't know quite how to express it sometimes. But he was a deeply affectionate man and loved his friends and depended on their prayers and their friendship. And that's why he didn't always realize just, again, the complexities with which he had to deal with in various circumstances, because he tended to think well of people. We are very grateful to be here tonight, to have this opportunity, and he would have most of all appreciated our prayers for him. And to be surrounded by what I'm sure is true, by a deep sense of affection. It's sad too that we are mourning Michael. But again, a thoroughly good man, rather different in temperament from Matthew in some ways, but with that straightforward love of our Blessed Lord and Our Lady, which he always felt he had particularly inherited from his mother's family, the Riddles. So, dear Matthew, we pray for you. My instinct is that he won't have very long, whatever that means, the terms of eternity, in purgatory, because he suffered and was not always well treated. But in the end, neither was our blessed Lord. And we follow a crucified Savior who makes sense of pain and sorrow and suffering. And so we can say, with heartfelt devotion, eternal rest grant to him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen.